All right, so welcome to the course. My name is Justin David Pineda, and I will be your instructor for the term. And as with the other courses, the first meeting is all about the course introduction. Okay, so the agenda for today is to getting to know. Okay, so I'll ask you to introduce yourself. Write something in the learning platform for me to get to know you. Right, discuss the grading system, the groupings, the house rules, and then the syllabus, and then some information about the course and cybersecurity, of course. Right. So about me, my entire career has been in cybersecurity, and I shifted to. From one cybersecurity domain to another. So cybersecurity has been my bread and butter, my life for the past X number of years. So I started with an MSSP or Managed Security Service provider called Silver Sky, where we manage banks in the United States, more than 500 banks and credit unions, and then it was a good job because we had to analyze various attacks and respond to it. And during that time, technology was not so sophisticated back then, so we had to do a lot of manual work. And so that's my first work, and then I moved to Coca-Cola, where I learned pen testing, and I did that for a couple of years until later on I moved to governance, risk, and compliance in a local conglomerate here in the Philippines called JG Summit Holdings Incorporated. So if you know the different companies like URC, Robinson's Retail, Robinson's Land, Robinson's Bank, Summit Media, and so on. So that's the holding company, JG Summit. So I worked there. And then later on, I went to another domain for a consulting organization called BNext. And I was part of the management team there, preparing everything from the service portfolios to project implementation and so on. And then I moved to security strategy in Inga Micro, and then later on to Alorica as part of the security architecture group, helping secure contact center sites globally, as well as ensuring that the customers are compliant with various security regulations. And presently, I'm the president of Pineda Cybersecurity, and I built and I started this organization back in 2017. I have around 12 consultants with me doing a lot of cybersecurity consulting work for SMEs. And so yeah, that's my background, and here are some of my certifications. So if you need help, or if you plan to take industry certification in the future, hopefully I can assist you and guide you with that. All right. So let's now go to the grading system. The grading system is very straightforward. So we have four components. So the first component is recitation, which of course is done individually and done every meeting. So we do our discussions, I have my lecture, and of course you need to engage in the discussion. So it will be in a roll call method. So I'll call each one of the students present in the class, and it will be your chance to speak and answer. question. So you need to participate in each class to get recitation score. So that's the first one, and I think that's the easiest because you already know what lessons we're going to study for that day. Okay. The second is exercise, which is 30%. So it's usually done by group, and it can range from case study, hands-on exercise. It depends on the topic, and it's important to have a group because it will help you simulate what's happening in the real world. You cannot do things alone, so you have to work with the team, work with your with your teammates, and adjust and adapt when necessary. So teamwork makes the dream work, they say. And then next is quizzes. Okay, this is of course individual. We have 3 quizzes for the entire term. So that's 30%. And the last would be final exam, which would be a multiple choice exam, 30%. Okay, the passing is 70. Now, for the groupings, which you will do this offline, you choose your groups, minimum of 2 and maximum of 4. And now the requirements, just choose a group leader. So the group leader is the one responsible for disseminating the information to the group, ensuring that the deliverable is submitted on time, and then think of a group name. Okay, now the third is only one member is required to submit the group report. So every meeting, okay, you'll need to submit something. So you can submit the combined or consolidated inputs, and then one member will submit the group report. And then last would be there will be peer evaluation. So just to do a 360 check whether the members are doing their jobs. And the leader is also doing his or her responsibility. So that would check each other's task and performance. All right. So for the house rules, so it will depend. So we'll both have online sessions and face-to-face sessions. So all materials can be found in my website. So, so the background is because cybersecurity has been my life. So I'm also teaching cybersecurity, different cybersecurity courses to different schools. So I put all of the materials in my website, justinpineda.com, and I also have and put copies of the files that we used in whatever learning platform we're using, right? But the latest ones would be found in the website. So later on, even after the course, if you want to see what's the latest in, let's say, ethical hacking, it will be there. So you can check it out. Yeah, so there you can bookmark it, and then you can download the files also directly from my site. Now, the deliverables must be uploaded in the learning platform, whatever that is. Maybe a group report, you have your assignment, and so on and so forth. So do it. Put it there. Okay. And then, of course, attend the class sessions. May it be online. Okay. If it is synchronous, we will have asynchronous sessions. Okay. And then we will have face-to-face sessions also. You need to participate in the discussion and exercises. So you're expected to, during face-to-face discussions, synchronous sessions, that you have some input already. And you need to be able to articulate it in the class. So we in the class, I personally want to hear your opinion about certain matters, whether there's such thing as ethical hacking, if hacking back is legal for you in your eyes or should be done, and other things, no? So you have to participate. and you know, have your voice heard. And then you need to make sure that weekly requirements have been submitted. So, depending again on the learning platform, you will be updated whether you have submitted or not. So you have to check. And if there are issues or challenges, feel free to reach me at justinp@pinedacybersecurity.com. So you can also reach me to my school email. Okay, but I always check my corporate or business email, so you can direct it to me if it's urgent. And let's help each other make this course successful. It's not only me, but of course, it's about you. Again, I'm a part-timer, so it's not like I'm here to make your lives hard, to make it difficult for you and give you a lot of work. So I'm here to spread the word about cybersecurity, entice you and invite you to explore the different domains and help you later on in your career. So think of me as that person. Okay? So online class netiquette. So just a quick run through, because for synchronous online sessions, always ensure that you're in mute when you are not talking, and then unmute when it's your turn to talk. If you can turn on your video when you're talking best, so we can have a better interaction. Okay, but if you have limited data, okay, no need to turn on. Okay, but unmute when you speak. So we can also, or I can also entertain answers posted in the chat window in whatever platform that we used. Okay, so treat everyone in the class with respect, obviously, right? And then you can also use your raise hand feature. Okay, and then avoid accessing games, social media, and other apps and websites unrelated to the discussion. And I'm coming from the perspective of an outsider, so I will not, you know, check each one of you from time to time. So you're grown people. You have to be responsible. So I'm expecting that you're participating during class time. Okay. So for the course material, so it's here now. So you can bookmark my page. Okay, then you can read in advance. You can check other courses as well. Right, so everything is there. Feel free to navigate. Okay. So this is an example for Module 1 General Security Concepts. Right, so that's it. And then there are also modules that have a corresponding online lecture. So we will discuss this in class. At the same time, you can check it out too. First, if you can sleep at night, that will make you sleepy. But kidding aside, you can get the full picture, because at times during the synchronous sessions, you might miss some details because we're entertaining other questions and other concerns. But in the online lecture, obviously we're going to run through each of the topics. Right, so you can also subscribe, because I keep this updated with new topics. Right, so for the learning process, so everything will be provided to you. Okay, up to you to use them. Up to you what strategy you're going to use. Right, so what does it mean? So if you're not into reading the chapter of the book, because it's there, okay, then go to the slides. If you're not into a slides, not into to viewing slides, you can go to the videos, learning videos. If not, go to reference material. So there are a lot of options, up to you to choose. But there's no excuse not, you know, not prepared coming into class. Use the asynchronous time to read the materials, analyze the cases, discuss in the group, and finish the deliverables. So you have to make yourselves productive, because the third one is a fruitful discussion is expected during the sync session. It is expected that you have come to class prepared. And then you can send questions via the learning platform or the email. So the course syllabus will be uploaded in the learning platform. And then for questions, you can reach out to me. Now, so these are the house rules. These are the, you know, admin stuff. Let's go a little bit to the cybersecurity as a profession, because this will give you an idea what we're doing and what the purpose is of the different domains and why am I here teaching the course. So here we have an article from Forbes.com. Now, Isaka, so in security, you have to, later on, you have to join some reputable cybersecurity organizations, one of which is Isaka. So Isaka is a non-profit information security advocacy group. So you will meet different executives, different security professionals there. Now, if you would notice here, although this is a little outdated because the numbers keep on rising. So every year in the US, 40,000 jobs for information security analysts go unfilled, and employers are struggling to fill 200,000 other cybersecurity related roles. So imagine that is only for the US, 40,000, specifically for security analysts. That's just one role, and another 200,000. Okay, so and for every 10 security job ads, only 7 people even click on one of the ads. That's the ratio. So meaning to say, the demand for security professionals is high, but supply is low globally. Another is from CSO Online, very good source of cybersecurity news, right? So it is estimated that by 2014, very like 10 years old, the industry will be short more than a million security professionals across the globe. And then there is a prediction that in 2021, 3.5 million unfilled cybersecurity positions globally. And they were wrong because they did not take into account the pandemic, so it almost doubled. So every IT position is also a cybersecurity position now. And look at the third bullet: cybersecurity unemployment rate was 0% in 2016, and is expected to remain there. So it means you won't run out of job if you're in cybersecurity, right? Another is from Indeed. Again, I think this was related to the article about the number of jobs posted and the number of clicks. So if you would notice, depending on the country, you have more postings, job postings, than the actual people who click it. And not only that, those people who click it, of course, we still have to filter them. Some of them may have just clicked it, but they're not qualified. Right? So that's the gap. So there. Now, let's now go to the common misconception in security. So in security, there is a common security misconception that there are only two teams. You have the red team and the blue team. So when we say the red team, you have the attackers, the defenders would be the blue team, and this is normal for most organizations. Actually, for most organizations, they have the blue team in place because, of course, we have to put our defenses. We have to put our firewalls. We have to put our antivirus, anti-malware, EDR, MDR, and so on. And we need somebody who will be working on that. Blue team. And then, we need to simulate attacks, whether these defenses that we placed are working or are performing as planned. So we have the attackers, so there's the red team. Now, that's a common misconception that there are only two teams. And for those who would like to explore security, cybersecurity, this may be quite intimidating because, for example, in blue team, I need to know some networking, I need to know some programming and analysis. For red teaming, I also need to know some networking and programming, etc., etc. Okay. So where will I start now? In actual practice, there are actually options for you. So apart from the red team and the blue team, you have other colors. We call it the InfoSec wheel. Okay. So in the actual practice, there are 7 teams. So you have we already discussed blue and red. And then if you're into research, if you're into doing work, research work, identifying which ones are the potential attacks that can target your organization and pass the intel to your blue team, then most probably you're into the purple team. Because it integrates defensive tactics with offensive results. So you also provide insights to the red team too. If you're into automation, right, because a lot of the security work can be done using automation, automating the patches, automating the checks, security checks, and so on and so forth. Most probably, you're fit in the green team. If you're into building, designing, architecting, right, systems or infrastructure, end-to-end. So from the authentication to the network, to the infrastructure, to the servers, etc., then you would be in yellow team. If you're more into security awareness and education, if you want to share the message, pass the message, then orange team might be good for you. And it's important. It's important. We cannot downplay the importance of security awareness. First, a lot of IT professionals are not outspoken. That's one. So if you're outspoken and you want to share the message, then that's a big plus already. You have the technical knowledge. Second, a lot of the attacks are social engineering attacks, and this could only be, contained primarily. Not only contained, there are different. There are a lot of ways to contain it, but the primary way of containing it or preventing it or mitigating a lot of social engineering attacks is through security awareness. And we know this. You have a lot of scams. We heard a lot of people clicking the link, and we need security awareness for people to be reminded not to do it, not to click it, not to submit personal information, credit card information, and so on. Orange team. And the last is the white team. So the white team would be more on the governance, risk, and compliance side. So they're the analyst, compliance, risk, and management. So if you would notice, if you browse through LinkedIn, there are security professionals whose background is not IT, especially in my team. There are a lot of professionals whose background would be on audit, on non-IT, no? And precisely because in my team, in other aspects, they would require critical thinking. They would require good risk management skills, okay, which may not be directly technical, but you need to ask the right questions and get the right information for you to make your analysis well. Okay, so the starting point, I think, would be to go to the most, you know, start with the most comfortable color, orange, yellow, green. I started with blue because when I was in Silver Sky, in blue team, part of the SOC, because because my thesis back then was about SIEM and SOC, so that's my comfort, you know, that's my comfort zone. And then I moved to red team when I was in Coca-Cola, and then I moved to white team when I was in JD Summit, and then I moved to yellow team, and then when I teach, I moved to orange team. So you can move from one color to another. So there, no? So that's the InfoSec quill. And depending on the cybersecurity course, it would focus on one color, right? One or two colors. Alright, so there. Now, let's move to security certifications. So in security certifications, we need to be, once you already know what path you want to go to, you have to choose your security certifications. And these are your certifications. Like for example, I want to focus on forensics, I want to focus on pen testing, I want to focus on this and that. So there are organizations that offer that. And the important thing here is that you need to choose reputable certifications. In IT, we don't have board exams. And in IT, this will make you competitive. Not an expert, right? But it's like a license. It will help you gain the right knowledge to standardize the knowledge. But of course, you need to have experience to balance it out. But what I'm saying is that there are a lot of organizations that offer a lot of security certifications. You have to choose the reputable ones and the ones that are right for you. Because there are certifications that are cheap, there are certifications that are expensive. Then later on, after you pass, you need to pay your maintenance fees, membership fees, and so on and so forth. So these are some of the security certifications and the organizations that offer these certifications. CompTIA or CompTIA, Easy Council, SANS, ISACA, ISC School, and there are a lot more. There are a lot more, but you need to check and do your due diligence because it's not, you know, this is not a light investment. So you have to put your effort, time, talent, and treasures, money to pay for the course and sit on a training, etc., etc. And then later on when you apply in a position, the employer doesn't know this particular certification. It means it's not reputable or it's new or something. So it's going to be waste. And so you have to choose the one that's right for you and make sure that you're going to use it afterwards. It's not just going to be a decoration. Alright, So there. So here's also an IT certification roadmap from CompTIA. And it focuses on different domains: security, network, hardware, IT, storage, web and mobile software, and training. And then the level: beginner, intermediate, advanced, expert. So it's not only offering CompTIA courses or CompTIA courses, but from other organizations and vendors as well. So you can use that as a guide. You don't need to take all of this, but it will be very, very helpful. All right. So there, no? And for further reading, you can check the different color teams, InfoSec teams, the color wheel, and other related reading materials for this course introduction. Okay, so there.